TV. Welcome everybody, my name is Leon van Rooij and this is a new episode of Playgrounds TV. It's the first episode in the new year and it's a really special one because we invited a guest that was at Playgrounds 10 years ago. He did a marvelous presentation in Amsterdam. And in that time, he did like a lot of great projects, and we are definitely going to discuss them. He's an Oscar and a shortlisted BAFTA winner, and recently the director of the wonderful, lovely Robin, screening on Netflix. May I have a big applause for Mr. Mikey, please?
Thank you, Leon. So nice to be back talking to you.
Yes, so great to see you again. And was this like a kind of an introduction that matches? Is it like Mikey, yes, please, or Mikey, please?
I like the yes in there. The yes is good. You know, yeah. It's positive and affirmative.
For me, it was so cool. That was like our first introduction. We even didn't met yet. And then you send us your passport, and it was like, you have to wait like a few weeks because I get another passport, because I'm going to add like the yes towards it. So it became Mike, yes, please. And yeah, that's a historical moment in the production office that they actually have to change all this kind of stuff. Yeah. But that said, Mikey, after 2012, you were like not sitting still. You did like a lot of jobs. And great projects. But before we're going to kick off, for those who don't know you yet, how did you start making films? What was like for you the first step in the filmmaking?
The first step into filmmaking? Well, funnily enough, so when I was 8 years old, I used to go to Aardman Animation, which is near to where I grew up in Bristol, and make these like really disgusting, violent stop motion animations of like things exploding and stuff. And so that I really love filmmaking and special effects. I was always fascinated by like special effects in movies. And so I had that from quite young. And then when I went to uni, I went and did a sort of practical special effects course, which is like animatronics and sculpting. And it was run by all the old Jim Henderson guys. So it was a really kind of special course that was sort of amazing it even existed. And when I was there, I started making short films. And that's actually when I first met Dan Ojari, who I've just co-directed Robin with at Aardman. So it feels like a very nice like full circle that kind of ended up back there to make this pretty hefty project.
Yeah. Hey, and there's like a lot of choices in filmmaking. You were attracted by visual effects and what you just said, animatronics. And is the tactility for you an important part of it? Like actually the making of it?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think I also like to have a nice time while making something. I do a lot of loads of work on computer, you know, probably most of my day is on the computer, but certainly like the practical craft of animation, you know, wherever there's the opportunity to do something physical, even if it's like pencil on paper or sculpting or getting your hands dirty with some material, that's like a really good day when I get to do that. So yeah, the craft and the tactility, as you put it, is really important. I think what it is seeing some humanity in the work. I always think that's the thing that builds a kind of empathetic bridge between an audience and a film. When they can understand just a tiny bit of how something is made, you can kind of relate to it a little bit more. Yeah.
I agree, and we go to a quite an important project for you, the Eagleman Stag. Let's watch for a little clip so people can see the tactility, the humanity, but also a huge skill in craftsmanship. So.
We've been here for 2 hours, which makes up less than a 150,000th of my life thus far. Whereas for my eldest child, the same amount of time is, well, it's 14 times more. Time for him is so potent. I am deeply jealous, and these thoughts return to me often.
Right. This was like a really important film for you, right?
It was absolutely. So, I mean, 10 years ago. So I was 24, I think, when I made that. So I was, spring chicken. And I think everything I'd made up to that point, I just couldn't watch it. I couldn't even be in a room with anyone to watch it. And my toes would sort of curl under. And that was the film I made at the Royal College of Art. And it was a few experiments I'd been doing with kind of like monochromatic stop motion, and I just had discovered this material in the back of a lighting sheet, which was like yoga mat foam called Plastisote. And so there was a few things that kind of aligned on it. There was firstly the script was, and the story is probably the most important element of it, which was something I'd like been thinking about since childhood. Pretty much I remember going to school and being like, why do the summer holidays not feel as long this year, the last year that. And so the idea of time perception getting shorter as you grow, or speeding up as you grow older, had been something that always bothered me. And so the story, I felt, was like, this is a solid story. I feel it's worth putting everything I have into it. And I feel like I was quite lucky in a way that I had also found these few little technical things that were sort of at the right point. And I mean, it was the last... not the last, but like, because it was a graduation film, it was something I had complete control over every aspect of it. You know, as you expand your team and expand people you work with, you have to relinquish control in a good way to lots of other brilliant craftspeople and collaborators. But that film was kind of one that I was just on my own, pretty much in a basement with a few friends who would come along and help out for an afternoon. But yeah, it was a cool one. I look back on it very fondly. I haven't watched that trailer in like
10 years. Probably.
It's so strange to see.
Yeah. But it also shows your huge, of your so skilled eye for details, right? So everything is like so well thought, well sculpted. And I can imagine that like working in foam isn't that easy material all the time, right?
Well, funnily, I mean, it's there's unforgiving things about it, but actually, if I think back on it now, what's so great about it is that it's just so immediate. You can't refine it. It's like doing a life drawing. You know, you have to get it in the first stroke pretty much, because you have to use a really sharp scalpel blade and you have to go, and if it works, it works. And if it doesn't, you have to start again. And so actually it's really fast material to work with, because you can't endlessly tweak it.
Yeah,
a great thing.
But it also shows your skill, because if there is no Control Z button, I can also imagine that you really have to be like skilled in your. It's kind of that muscle memory, right? So if you have that in mind, it should work quite quickly, because otherwise you can do it like 10 times over to get the perfect line.
Yeah, I think that's what makes stop motion perhaps more similar to live action, maybe than other forms of animation, in that it is a performance. You are like, I could get really nervous like before going into animated shot, because it's like stepping onto stage. You're like, whew, okay, I better not screw this up. And there isn't an Apple Z button on it. And it's all about the preparation that you go into it. And I've learned, you know, a huge amount since doing that. You know, now we prepare a lot more than I would for those shots, with like references and, you know, pre-vises and all those sorts of things. But it's nice just sort of doing something and that being it, you know, for its warts and everything. It's good.
Hey, and it was also an introduction. This film was like a huge success, like screened in a lot of festivals, a humongous amount of awards. And I think also a good, like, introduction in the field of advertising and commercials. This is one that you did for the British Bake Off. Can you tell, like, how you came up to this concept? And then I can show it.
So this was a really fun project. We were asked by Channel 4 to do this animated trailer for the Great British Bake Off, which is like the most beloved show on television in the UK. And it had been taken by Channel 4, taken from the BBC, and sort of so there was a lot of like anxiety about it. And so we wanted to do something that was about ingredients coming together and being stronger. And it was around the time of Brexit as well, so we were like, you know, let's do something about like unity and like actually we are stronger together. Anyway, so the whole thing is like one big experiment. You know, we're all using real foods all the way, and yeah, lots of fun little accidents happened along the way while filming it, which made it into the final thing. But you'll see.
All right, let's watch it.
Set your egg timers. The Great British Bake Off is back. Coming soon.
On Channel.
All right. This was made with so much fun and enthusiasm, right? You can actually see that it's like shining through everything.
Yeah, it was a really fun project to make. And the funny thing is that it was the first thing we'd done which was like really in the public sphere, you know. And so it wasn't just the arts community looking at it and saying, oh, that's so nice, look at the details. It was the morning it got released, and I was just like feeding my son some mashed potato, and I was like, oh, I wonder what the public reaction is. And I googled it, you know, like when you google a news story and you get all these little thumbnails along the top, and every national newspaper had a headline in it which was the Great British Bake Off like freaks people out with its new trailer. And like some of the headlines were like, Great British Bake Off trailer causes mass hysteria, and like fans are outraged. And I was like, oh my god, what have we done? And like I went pale, and I called up the guys, the agent, the creators at Channel 4. I was like, I'm so sorry, we blew it. And they're like, no, this is amazing. This is the best reaction we could have hoped for. I mean, that's the whole reason we did animation. It's just, you know, there's no real people involved, so it can take all the bullets. But they're like, oh, I'm a real person. Anyway, that's great. That is what you were expecting. Fine.
but I think it's one of the best commercials ever. So well done, Mr. Please. Yeah, this is another project that you did, Alan the Infinite. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Yeah, so around 2014, Dan Ojari and I set up this studio called Parabella, strange and beautiful Parabella. And initially, it was just to share equipment and a space and a shooting space for both stop motion animators. But what we found actually is we were sharing the real gold, which was our ideas. And Robin was one of our very early concepts that we worked on together, and Alan the Infinite was another one. And while Robin was kind of, because it was so clearly within a genre, we felt we could convey what it was just quite simply in a storybook, and that's what we did, which you'll talk about in a minute. But Alan the Infinite is a most wonderful, cherished project. It's a kind of a long form story. We made this 11 minute kind of proof of concept, and it's about a boy who goes to intern at this lamination factory, and hoping that this will be his big break into his career and it'll be a job for life. And like, if he can just impress his boss, he'll have his future mapped out for him until he retires. But what he discovers is that the lamination factory is actually a front for this secret organization who are trying to discover the root of infinity, so the cause of all change in the universe, and they're trying to laminate it so that nothing will ever change ever again. And so Alan is caught between this, like, really wanting to impress his boss by, like, helping him laminate infinity, but also having all these sort of young struggles of a young teenager. So it's quite a sort of strange, in a way, sort of slightly esoteric concept. Hence, we made a lot of effort to do this proof of concept film. So now that we could have completed them both around the same time, the pitch for Robin and the pilot for Alan the Infinite, and Robin just sort of leapt ahead. So we're this is kind of our next baby that we're hoping to birth into the world.
Let's watch a little clip of it.
Cool.
First day as a job, but it's not a job, it's work experience. It's what my school sent me on to find out what I'm gonna be when I grow up.
Lamination turns a pathetic piece of paper into something that will last forever.
Choo choo.
There you go.
And nothing says forever like lamination. Watching you all. Let go!
Business cards, I've got loads of them actually. I've got about 10.
Beautifully made, and what you just explained with the Eagleman Stag, you also see like the human touch on it, right? You see actually the paint, it's almost like how you created the little cubes and the wood, etc. It gives a beautiful magical touch to it as well in this wonderful story.
Yeah, oh, thanks. Yeah, we're very keen always on having the material right at the forefront, and with this, with Alan the Infinite, it was all wood. You know, we'd used a lot of balsa wood and these nice block primary shapes, which we could then 3D map that 2D really expressive animation onto. So it is about sort of leaning into the benefits of a material, but at the same time, not just ignoring technology and ignoring its weaknesses as well. You have to like accept that some things are better done in other processes. So like we love 2D animation particularly because it's so expressive, it's so fantastic at conveying emotion and performance, and so yeah, we felt that process of like a volumetric world built in wood with these 2D faces on was a really nice
it's like if the building blocks of our universe, right?
Yes, exactly, Leon.
Hey, a total different thing, but it also shows your, passion for storytelling in all kind of ways. You're working together also with Jano Jujari on a graphic novel. Do you find any time actually to do this between all those kind of projects?
Well, this one is one that has sort of been filling the cracks of our time. Filling the crack, that sounds horrible, doesn't it?
It's like filling up spaces.
Filling up the space in between, that's a nicer way. But this has probably been going since about 5 or 6 years now. We've been working on this and it's nearly complete, but every time we have a little gap in production and we're like, okay, we've got a month, like let's do this, we reopen it. And we're like, ah, oh, we can make this so much better here and here and here. So it's gradually got more and more complicated over these 6 years. What was like initially we made 6 issues of these like 24-page comics, and we're like, yeah, it's good, but it doesn't have the sort of the depth or the grounding in character the proper character arc that we wanted for it. So then we were like adding pages and adding scenes, and then now it's like this 300-page massive tomb, and we are close to completing it. We should hopefully next year we'll see its completion. But yeah, it's been an amazing project to have. It's a really nice one as well, because it doesn't take a big production facility. You know, these are just my illustrations, and so Dan and I will both write it together, and then we'll work on the layouts, and then I'll do the kind of the final art. And yeah, it's been just a really wonderful project to kind of explore a new medium. You know, we haven't done comic books before. Obviously, they have a lot akin to storyboards and design, and there's loads of crossovers, but a graphic novel is a new venture, but one that we...
Yeah, and I can also imagine with you working on so many time-consuming, intensive pre-producing, and with like a whole of teams, there's like so many layers in it, that this is really from your creative mind straight to the paper. It's like a really fast pace in that sense, a faster pace than you're used to be.
Sure. Like, you know, the scale of story that you can tell in a comic is just like, oh, I shouldn't be allowed to do this, but you are. And since doing it, everyone I talk to who's starting out, I always recommend like doing comic books, because they're such an amazing way of figuring out the foundation of story. And then they're so similar to filmmaking in that you're dealing with, you know, each panel is a cut, and you're dealing with opposing emotions, and there's pacing, and, you know, the size of the panel is the kind of the weight that you give that moment. So there's loads of parallel practices between the two. And comics, even if the drawing's kind of scrappy, what you're doing is you're just showing symbols. You know, you could do a comic just of purely, it wouldn't be very exciting to look at, but like emoticons, you know, or like really simple symbolic images and words told in sequence is filmmaking. It is storytelling.
Yeah, like just before this interview, I did one with Amede Jong, who created a beautiful graphic novel called Day of Sand. Definitely check it out. Yeah. And she was also like explaining like how storytelling with film, how you can not translate it, but that comic reading a graphic novel is a total different kind of experience. So you use a different kind of technique. Of course, there is like also similar techniques, but also different kind of techniques of how to tell a story. For example, like how a page turner works in revealing the next step or the next scene, and what your eye sees first, and how you can steer it, etc. And it was really interesting actually to see that like telling a story in a graphic novel, it's so much different, but you can use those techniques as well. In animation, for example, and it can enrich the way you approach a story.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely.
It's funny that you're like experimenting a lot, because you also did board games, you did like all different kind of elements. Is that also something that you want to explore, how to tell stories in different ways to create a kind of a toolbox?
I think that's the sort of foundation of all the interests, is for sure board games, storytelling.
Yeah, storytelling and in general. Yeah.
Me and my wife, just like, it'd be cool to do a project together, and like, where do we overlap? And that was something we're both like, yeah, love that. So that was a kind of one-off. I don't think we're going to launch into a board game empire, but I have been doing loads of book projects. You know, there's the Deadrock graphic novel, but I've also like just writing. So I've done sort of a young adult and various other short story collections. Like, yeah, just anything that has storytelling in it, and just a sucker for.
All right. Hey, and all that knowledge and all that experience and all that like doing a lot of projects and skills, it brought you to this project, which was an ambitious project, I can imagine.
Yes. And a beautiful monster.
Hey, and it recently premiered on Netflix, a big success. How was it for you to, for the first time, work in such a big kind of context, like with so many people involved and these huge sets, etc.?
Yeah, so it was, so for context, this was a project that we developed at Parabella, and then we took it to Aardman and pitched it there, and they were as excited as we were about making it into a half hour Christmas special, and then we pitched it to Netflix and they got on just as excited as we were. But in terms of the scale up, like, the practical side of it was kind of fine, because even though, you know, it's half an hour and we've done 12 minute things, it's just like you have a longer time to do it. And it's actually, if anything, because you have more people, it was easier, on a practical level. But what was difficult, the difficult thing is the story structure. And that's weird. You know, we had come up with this idea in 2014, and it was just a conversational thing between Dan and I one evening in our studio. And we're like, yeah, Robin raised by family of mice. And yeah, that'd be awesome. And there's loads of ways you can take it. And we developed this quite sort of simplistic storybook version of it, told in silhouettes. And we're like, yeah, it really holds together and you can see it. But by the time that we then took it to Aardman and started working with a brilliant team of story artists, we found that, oh, we're just at the bottom of a mountain. You know, we thought that we had it locked. We thought we were just coloring in, but we're totally wrong. You know, to hold together it's kind of I say this modestly, it's a feature film idea compressed into half an hour. It's not really, but it's got the arc of a kind of a feature.
I can imagine that when doing a short of like 5 minutes or doing a film of 30 minutes, it's a total different approach of storytelling.
Absolutely. You really have to dig deep on the character. You can't let a situation or side characters steal the show. It has to be everything pinned on your protagonist. Well, that's what we found anyway with this film, which was that what we had come to Aardman with as our sort of tent poles of the story, which was like bird falls into rubbish dump, raised by mice, grows up, doesn't feel like she quite belongs, goes on an adventure, meets a magpie to steal a Christmas star. I won't spoil the rest, but you know, we had these beats. But actually, it wasn't really driven by Robin. It wasn't enough about her. And we hadn't got to the bottom of who she was and what was really concerning her. And actually, that was like a massive, massive learning curve, doing something that length of just how delicate a story is and how rigorous you have to be with your approach of like, ah, oh, that kind of feels okay, isn't good enough. It has to be absolutely watertight. And so we were lucky once we got to Aardman, and we had also, some of the artwork shown there was, we'd worked with a fantastic illustrator called Bryony May Smith to do us some concept art. And so that really helped kind of convince Aardman that this was a really good idea. So once we got to Aardman, we then worked with this amazing team of storyboard artists, and also the Bookshop Band, who are longtime musical collaborators. So the film's also a musical, if you haven't seen it. So that was a new thing for us to get our heads around. So we're like, oh yeah, we've definitely sold this as a musical, so let's try. But yeah, so we're working with the Bookshop Band, one of whom is my brother. So we've worked with him since the Eagleman Stag and Alan the Infinite, like all that music you've heard in those trailers is him and Beth Porter. And so that was really cool to kind of have them as a core part of the story team right at the beginning, because what it meant is that we could like feed things back and forth to them. And so the music really helped us like build a foundation to the film. You know, so we could not everything in the film is responding to music, but huge sections of the film are kind of like a music video. You know, you're like responding visually to this spine.
Yeah. Was that one of the strategies to make a kind of a storytelling collection of music videos? So really thinking about like these sets as like a compilation of music videos that tells the story when you watch them all together. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. I don't know. Maybe not.
Yeah, I don't know. I can imagine that it's a different way of working. I can. Of course, there is this narrative, and it's really thought out. But approaching it on like how to make it kind of a musical. It's like making a song next to a song, bringing it to a song, and make it work in that sense. So for me, it felt really like one beautiful scenes, and all together it was such a wonderful experience. Yeah.
Ah, cool. Yeah, I mean, there's definitely like Magpie's song, which actually we had figured that one out a little bit before we took it to Armin. So in the canteen at Annecy Film Festival, which is where we pitched it, ended up like singing Magpie's song to Sarah Cox, who's the development executive at Aardman, who brought in the project. But yeah, there are like fun and games songs in there, but most of the songs, because it was only half an hour, we had very, very little room to go off on tangents. All the songs are like doing very, very, very specific story things. And that's why, so Dan and I wrote the lyrics to all the songs, and I'm sure the Bookshop Band would have done a better job of writing the lyrics, but because we were writing the script and the songs were parts of the script, we had to.
Did it make that extra challenging for you? I can imagine, like also doing this kind of in a musical setup, and writing it and doing like 30 minutes, etc. So it was like not an easy way for you. I think it was quite nice puzzle creatively.
It is a nice puzzle. That's a nice way of putting it. Yeah, but really like a joy. I mean,
Joy is like spread off all every frame of it. So that's. Beautifully done. Hey, and then Netflix stepped in. I see, like, whoa.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. I mean, they were such incredible partners for us, like really supportive. Of course, we got slammed by a pandemic in the middle of production, like we'd just started shooting. And so we were really nervous that, like, you know, is this going to be it? All this stuff. But actually, you know, Netflix was just so supportive of all the challenges that we faced, and in terms of kind of giving notes and things, you know, we had lots of really helpful notes from them, but there was never the sort of pressure to like fall in line or something. You know, it was always, there was a lot of trust, which I think is a good dynamic, because the trust puts the pressure on us to try and do the best thing. You know, we were never in a position where we could like blame an executive on some like, oh, they made us, you know, do this thing. There was never that get out opportunity.
Yeah. Hey, but with this as your platform, it reaches to a lot of people all over the world, because it was like actually also aired like as this Christmas setup like last week or 2 weeks ago. What you already explained, 30 minutes, every detail counts. So you work with like a story team, and this is like a color script. Can you tell us a little bit like about the process of this? How do you approach this?
So this is a fantastic color script put together by Jose Prats, who's a fantastic animation director in his own right, and it was just a really helpful way, not just for us, but for the whole team, really, to see the film as a whole, you know. And color was a very important element for us. So you'll see when we start to talk about like some production design and things, but we really wanted like, you know, the color to tell a story. So yeah, it was really cool. So we had all of these references, which would be kind of pinned up above the set, and for our DOP to try and, you know, emulate these lighting choices. So it's an amazing asset.
Yeah, it's cold outside and it's like so warm and gloomy inside, right? So you actually see like almost the British Bake Off kind of knispery pastry in the middle, and like the cold outside is a really beautiful balance.
That's right.
Can you tell us a little bit about this? This is like an interesting...
Well, this was part of our sort of musical journey of like learning, I suppose, not just about musical structure, but kind of narrative score structure. So this is a music script, or like a musical theme script. So each of those things along the top is like each character, and sometimes the kind of the film as a whole has a theme to it. And it was a really helpful way of like kind of joining the dots to be like, okay, you know, that red splash there is like Robin's theme, and we really need to bring it back in here. So we would kind of, you could visually see where there were things missing and be like, oh, we've, you know, this should, this moment needs to be a mirror of this moment, but it's mixed with this. So that this is a visual representation of actually a really dull looking spreadsheet.
Well, yeah. But I can imagine that when having such a big project, and a pre-production in this is, of course, key, because you really want to know at first that everything works. So everything that's like helps you to have a good overview on this kind of amount of workloads, I can imagine for you as a director, this is really helpful to to have a good insight about like what the team, but also like the look and feel, but also the... how do you say how it mesmerizes with the audience in that sense?
Yeah, definitely. Like you say, it's a fun puzzle. You know, it's you can just sort of, you're constantly making connections in storytelling, and so the more you can find tools to help you visualize those connections, the better.
And we are looking here. We call this like thumps, making thumbnailing kind of solutions and gaining ideas in your sketchbook. You do that like a lot. You're plotting it out all over and then make it visual to discuss it with your co-director, of course.
Yeah, of course. So I started keeping a sketchbook kind of early on in the project, and by the end, actually kind of have them somewhere around here. But I've got like a stack of about 6 kind of very densely packed sketchbooks, just all with the thumbnails. But it's a really, as I was saying earlier, just any opportunity to put like pencil to paper and work very directly is always a pleasure. And so all of those sketches are just briefing tools for the proper storyboard artists. So we had a fantastic team of 7 or 8 artists who would then put together these animatics. And the animatic, you know, we would do so many versions of each scene, so many different ways to slice the cake. But once we knew the animatics were working, kind of the rest of the process is a pleasure, because you're just building on top of this foundation that you know is going to work, because you've seen it work in this kind of almost like comic book style.
Yeah, I can imagine that for you, like, and it's sometimes a difficult thing for people who are just starting off to actually show and discuss it. I can imagine that, like, sometimes it's keeping it for yourself, what you just mentioned with your graduation film. You could hide yourself in your own studio, and you're controlling everything, but working in a team for, like, a global audience, that it's a kind of a communication in that sense, your storytelling, that should relate to a lot of different people all over the world. So if a scene works, yes or no, I can imagine for you that's really something important to check and double check it. So there's a lot of discussion.
I think that's one of the great benefits of being with other people and not being an island, you know. And so that was one of the great things about starting to work with Dan, is that, you know, both of us had to externalize our ideas all the time. And as soon, because you can feel like something works, and as long as it's like protected inside your head, you never have to put it under any scrutiny, and it'll work forever inside your head. But as soon as it's outside, it has to stand up by itself. And so that's the great thing about working with other artists who are experts in their field.
And adding their values to it as well.
Yeah, totally. So this even that little thing just reminded me, like, Dave Diamond, one of the storyboard artists, he just like thrown in these gnomes on one of his sketches, and we're like, oh man, those gnomes are cool. And then it just became this whole thing, like, we designed these like giant gnomes, and like it became a real sort of like totem point of the film, of like Robin entering the new world, like in Lord of the Rings, you know, where you get these giant statues on the edge of the river. And we're like, yes, those gnomes. But we, you know, we'd never have like thought of that thing that could be a very small detail, but you realize it's quite important.
I spoke with Aaron Blaze a few weeks ago. He's like the director of Brother Bear, and I worked in the Disney thing. And he said, like, the most difficult thing for me, what I learned the most as becoming from an animator director into a director of these more bigger productions, is that actually to let go and trust more on your team, so mm-hmm. that actually that you also can let in new ideas and new perspectives, and actually trust on the value they can bring to the film. Was that also something that you experienced?
Absolutely, yeah. I think it's understanding that this thing that you're making isn't you. It's not you. You're not putting your heart on a table and letting everyone like poke it. It's a thing that needs to be built by everybody. And the more people can input on it, and the more people's opinions and the more people's expertise that look at it, the stronger it's going to be. And I think, you know, I've definitely sort of seen that happen in the opposite way, where people have been really overprotective of their thing and shutting everyone out, and it being, you know, not great, not a great way to build something. And so, yeah, absolutely. Like, the more you still need to have a strong sense of where you want it to go, but getting as many people as you can to like help you do it.
And if it has like it works in this playful atmosphere, then people, then also the fun and the love shines through it, right? Otherwise, it becomes so rigidly worked and blocked out, and not trying to make, how do you say, the fear of failing then drops in, right? Because it's never good with the director. So I can imagine that if they want to get the best out of it and they understand the vision of the director, and you give them some space to let that work, it shines through a scene or a shot or a character design.
I think it really did as well on this project. You know, the team was just so enthusiastic to like, I think also because it was something new at Aardman, you know, in a different style. And so there was a huge amount of like goodwill and enthusiasm for like trying out new things. And we had sort of suggest stuff like, you know, we don't want to use beads for eyes, you know, which is the very well, very successful route of building a stop motion puppet. We'd like to do something that feels a bit more graphic and 2D, so that we can play with the shapes of the eyes and things like that. And we were kind of expecting there to be this resistance to some of these ideas, but actually they were just really embraced. And then people would come and be like, oh, I found this really interesting solution, we can use like magnetic plates on the eyes, and be like, oh, that's amazing, you know. So definitely embracing everybody's expertise is such a healthy and positive thing.
Hey, and then everything is plotted and designed and thought through and checked and double checked, and then and a lot of Excels checking it out, and then it has to come alive, right? So then the animation, the materials, it should come from paper and bringing it to a set. Here we see some early tests.
I'm very clumsy, so I often spill things or like drop something on the floor, and someone's like, how did that get there? And I have no idea. How did that get there? Who knows? It wasn't me.
When you see this kind of clips, what happens then in the brain of a director?
Those two that you just showed were our kind of like our screen tests for our characters. They were before anyone had been cast. And so one of the things that we do is to like, before we like know who the voice talent is going to be, is to put them within the body of the puppet. Because sometimes you can have a brilliant audio performance, and you're like, oh, it's amazing. But then you put it with the physicality of a character and they just won't marry. There'll be something about like the size of the body and the smallness of the voice or something that just doesn't connect. And so we'd always do these screen tests. And these are two that obviously we were like, that clicks, you know, there's our character. And that one with Robin was the first time that Claire Rolls, one of our lead animators, had animated that, and we're like, we've suddenly like met our character, you know. He's been in our minds for
and actually you casted the perfect actor for telling your story then, right? When the sound works, with the materials works, with the animation works, then actually for the first time your actor that's going to bring your story alive is appealing for you.
Yeah, it's like appears for you. Yeah. It's a great, great moment. I mean, the voice and the performance, alongside the music, I think, are like the spine of a film. If you don't have those good voice performances and a good soundscape, it'd be impossible to make a good film. You know, it, like if those voice performances had fallen down and we'd still had everything else, I think the film would be very differently received.
For sure. And it's so beautifully designed. So it's so well balanced and everything looks so nice and so, how do you say, approachable and human and how do you say, I don't know if the right word, but sympathetic. Yeah, it really is like friendly in the right way of saying it. So,
Cool. Well, these, so that we worked very closely with our production and character designer, Matthew Forsyth, who's a fantastic Canadian illustrator and painter. And we've been huge fans of his for years. Like, if I took you on a tour of my house, you'll see his paintings all up the stairwell. And like, I just love his work. So we were thrilled to be able to get him on board with the project. And he'd had a huge influence, of course, on the look and feel of the film. One thing we really loved about these paintings was the kind of the depth of color. So how you can look at one little patch of it and it could be, it will read as green or it will read as red, but actually within it are a half dozen different hues all working together to kind of build an impression. And that felt really nice. And so one of the things I used to do with Eagleman was like the concept of a sort of increasing perception of time. I like try and build that idea into like lots of different places. So like with the sound, with the orchestra warming up, it like brrr, like goes up really high, and there's some cutting, like, you know, the cuts will get shorter and shorter and shorter, just to try and like layer this idea of things speeding up into like every element of the production. And Matt Forsyth's color layering felt very thematically in tune to what we're thinking about, which is like different things coming together and being stronger for their differences. So like we did that also with like the harmonies in the music. So, you know, two different notes layered on top of each other make a stronger harmony together. So the robin and the mice together, they're a bit different. When they join together, they're like a stronger family for those differences.
And in the meantime, I'm showing beautiful art when you were explaining us how you worked. But I also like it's what you just explained is really nicely layered, and but it's also really clear, right? So you always are like, it's quite, because it's animation, all the silhouetting, everything is really, how do you say, the open spaces that you're using, the colors that you're using, it's so readable. And still, what you already mentioned, it's almost graphic design meets illustration in a way. Am I right saying that?
That's spot on, yeah, definitely. So one of the things that we've discovered over the years is that I think what distinguishes Dan and I's approach to stop motion from perhaps a lot of other stop motion is that we like to have this very graphic, illustrative foundation to the world. So we build, most of the compositions are kind of built to the lens. You know, we don't build like a sandbox, we don't build a model village and then like place a camera around it. We're building graphic compositions to camera, which are very specifically laid out. And I kind of started doing it in Eagleman just as a economy, really, just because I was like, I can't build a whole set for this. Okay, I'm only going to see a corner of a table. That's just a piece of card in the corner, you know. But that visual approach of building things very graphically feels kind of fresh and exciting. And it means that you can put all the energy into what's going to be on screen. You know, you don't have to build the back of a tree if you're not going to see it. You just do the bit that you know is going to be on camera. But it does require a lot of planning.
It requires a lot of planning. But I think also what really shines through it is like really thinking thoroughly about it and approach it sometimes as a graphical design. It also takes the noise out. So like everything that you're showing is like is on the right spot and it's meant to be there, instead of like it's taking the attention away of the story of the world building.
Yeah. No, that's right. I mean, it's a very nice way to work.
Hey, but then everything is designed. You discuss it. Then you have to bring it from paper and from art into the real set. So everything should be built. And there's always like a difficulty because 2D is 2D and 3D is 3D. So there's this spatial extra layer to it, which also makes it happen that it looks from different kind of angles. So was that a big challenge to build the sets and all the and bringing it those things together?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, like kind of bless our art department. You know, we definitely really struggled, I think, because of the scale of it as well, you know, that to kind of get that adaptation correct from these, you know, we had these really fantastic concept paintings by Matt, but actually how we translated that into the real world, into the real 3D world, took a lot of R&D. And so, yeah, like just massive kudos to our art department for all the experimenting that we did, and again, you see all the sort of different layers of planning. I don't think...
Yeah, this is almost like using this 2D multiplane camera kind of effect into a 3D setup.
Yeah, so that would be like early way of testing out the sort of even just like the size and the layers and what needed to be built. But yeah, there are just so many steps.
Yeah, it's interesting because I spoke with Kurt Enderle, who was art director for Wes Anderson's Isle of Dogs and Box Trolls, etc. That, like, for people who don't know that much about stop motion, you all also have like different kind of sizes of puppets, right? Because they have to fit sometimes in the set as well. So it's not always the same puppet. There are like different scales of it, and all that kind of scale thing should be balanced out in everything.
Absolutely, yeah. So we had four scales of puppets, I think, ranging from like a little tiny ball of fluff for Robin up to like a kind of half real life size would be our B scale, then our A scale, which is double life size. And then, and then a C scale, which would be like a centimeter. So like kind of visible. So this is our A scale. And this is one of our first tests that we did, where we kind of had lots of elements of the world coming together and we were like, yes, it's going to work. So it was very, very satisfying.
It's so beautiful, Mikey. It's really like, if I'm seeing this, it's like also spot on. It's so beautifully textured. It's so beautifully colored, and the light and the design, it also comes so beautifully together. Yeah, these are like the characters, all the designs of the characters.
Yeah. So it was, so Matt Forsyth was our initial concept artist. And then at every stage, they then go to these fantastic sculptors called the Flynn Twins, who render them all in 3D, just as kind of clay sculpts. And then they go to Anne King, who's our head of puppets. And then with her team, it would be another layer of translation. And so with each translation, you face challenges of like retaining the core of the character or getting something right, or technical challenges of how's the skeleton of this puppet going to kind of keep the body shape nice and clear and graphic.
Here you can clearly see, like, if I go back one slide, using these kind of drawings and then translate them into these 3D models.
Yeah, the Flynn Twins had such a brilliant sensibility because they also are big fans of kind of that 2D graphic look, which we were trying to retain some of that in the 3D world. And
brilliant job. Yeah. Here you can also see like all the texturing.
Yeah. So we use needle felt. obviously, there's like a brilliant kind of growing tradition of needle felt in stop motion. But it was something that we've not done a great deal of before. So we had to kind of really learn how to use this material and how it was going to deform and the challenges and the boil. You know, the crawl, so whenever you touch it, it kind of wobbles a little bit, and getting the right level of boil was quite tricky.
Yeah, but it makes it really lifelike as well. So in that sense, what they always try to do in CG, you're now getting it from the real world, right? So it's not like this, all this kind of little hairs and stuff. It immediately looks really, and I think that's an important part of the whole storytelling, that it's in the sense of the emotions are believable, but also the characters are believable, right? And it adds value to the believability of the whole story if the materials works like we know them.
Absolutely. I think what, again, why we're drawn again and again to stop motion is that you do create that empathetic bond with something you can understand. If you can't understand it, I find anyway personally that I sort of shrug it off or something. You know, if I don't really understand how skyscrapers are made, and so I just sort of walk past them and don't pay them any attention. And maybe that's incredibly naive, but like I feel much more drawn to like a log cabin than I do a skyscraper, because I can see the joints and I can imagine to myself that like I could build one. So I think that's part of the attraction.
Yeah, it's part of also of the magic, right? You understand how it's done, but you don't exactly understand how it's done. But you could, if you do your best, you would understand how it's done. And it's the same with like table magic. Sometimes you see how they do it, but you don't understand how it comes alive, right?
So that's exactly. Exactly. So it is a magic. Yeah. So the magic is very important. Yeah. It's very important, and it's this magic trick that's happening.
And talking about magic and talking about animation, I'm just showing some movement tests and animation tests that you did. You're also looking for the right kind of movement, right? So is it like really cartoony? Is it anthropomorphic? Was it difficult for you also to think about, okay, of course you had the designs, but also how you want to make it move? Like what kind of...
Yeah, it's a really good question. Yeah, so we worked really closely with Ian Whitlock, who's our animation supervisor, and we tried out lots of styles of movement, of things being very kind of punchy, pose to pose, and exaggerated, and then on the other end of the scale, that naturalistic kind of on ones movement. And we probably landed somewhere in the middle where we wanted it to have a degree of naturalism, because naturalism was narratively important, because it's about different animals being different to each other. If they had all been anthropomorphized, if they all had had kind of forward bending knees, then they would kind of all be the same. And so it was really important, particularly for Robin, that she remained birdy. You know, her knees bend backwards as a bird does, and she kind of is quite flitty in her, like a bird, quite sort of pose to pose, whereas the mice are a lot more fluid and, you know, have a bit more swagger to them. So absolutely, you know, that's that next layer, you know. So you have Matt's designs, then the Flynn twin sculpts, and King's
broken wing
puppets, and then the animators bringing that other layer of characterization in the movement. So it is a combination of all of these different fantastic practitioners bringing their A game.
Yeah, and it also gives so much identity to it, right? Picking the, you can do like a great character design, like drawing and having the right mass, but also the movement adds so much identity to the character as well.
Mm, yeah, absolutely.
Or like drop something on the floor and someone's like, how did that get there? And I have no idea. How did that get there? Who knows? It wasn't me.
So you can see there, one of the like technical challenges we faced was Robin's head.
there is no neck.
Yeah, and a neck. We did so many different like complicated approaches to fixing that. And in the end, we just had this kind of an egg in an egg cup mechanism. And we're like, well, that's the simplest thing, but it's also perfect. And there was a fair degree, I think in this test, we didn't make any attempts to clean it up, but a fair degree of cleanup in terms of like adding little bits of felt, and then in post we cleaned it up a little bit digitally.
Oh, hello. I was just wondering if you could...
What has she seen?
But it's really well done because of the graphic approach to it, graphic design approach. Like you maybe know Dick Bruna and Miffy and all that kind of stuff. So there are like quite less elements that you can use for animation, right? So in facial expressions, you're quite dropped to like a few elements that you can use, right? I think it's so well done that even though with this limited ingredients, to create so much emotion and expression.
Yeah. No, it was great. I mean, being able to animate the pupils was a huge asset, but it also meant that we had to have like a dozen replacement little black discs for when the eyes went off to the side, because they don't go underneath the felt, they just have to sort of cut off at the edge. So lots of like little workarounds for that, to get that simplicity. It's actually quite complicated.
Yeah, it's complicated, but it all comes together then again with the visual language, so it's really readable, right?
Great. And so this is the sort of very bird-like behavior that I was talking about. And then our live-action references. So I think I mentioned this earlier of preparation for the shot, preparation for the performance. And because stop motion, you don't tend to get too much of a rehearsal. This was our way of, mine and Dan's way of testing out performances really easily. So there's a version of the film that's entirely this. of us, where we kind of comped ourselves into animatics or early
right
blocks.
Like fools, eh? Why is it you don't fly?
This is really funny to watch. I know you don't see that much this kind of thorough kind of reference materials.
and they're fun to do. You know, there's not a lot of like spontaneity you can inject once you're actually animating. You tend to have to follow quite strict cues. So being spontaneous in these live action references was a very nice part of the day.
Flightless fools, eh? Why is it you don't fly?
Sometimes we do get the opportunity, if the schedule allows it, to rehearse a shot before you fully animate it, so you get a sense of how
Yeah, because I can imagine it's quite hard with such a lot of elements that should be combined to have it all in one shooter, right? So it's sometimes not perfect in first takes.
No, exactly. I mean, even the thing like on this particular shot of like the unwinding of the beads, you're like, nah, you don't even really notice it in the final film, but my God.
Flightless fools, eh?
Okay, it's time to try to figure out.
Why is it you don't fly?
I mean, in the block, it doesn't particularly show it, but it was a real brain teaser.
This also looks like intense.
Yes, it's the inside of Magpie's tree when he does his throwing up his wing. It was probably one of our biggest sets. It was this huge, huge tower of incredible craftsmanship.
Yeah, it's beautifully done. I have no words for it. And then there is like also this little kind of special effects, also one of your passions. So this is like elemental magic. That's how they call it, like water drops and fire and smoke. These are like some tests that they did in 2D, and then try to translate it into more 3D kind of materials, right?
Exactly. So we were really keen that every element of the film kind of had needle felt or felt very tactile at its core. So we worked with those 2D references to kind of figure out the kind of movement and flow of these things. And then we would animate on multi-plane glass to get all the individual elements and then composite them into our final film. And so we actually had a very, I would say innovative approach to like how we integrated the effects was that we shot a lot of the film in stereoscopic, and this was an idea of our VFX supervisor John Biggins, and he was like, well, if we shoot it in stereoscopic, which means you have the camera on a slider and it shoots from the left eye and it slides across, shoots from the right eye and goes back, that because we then had that dual eye footage, we could then get all the 3D depth information. So we were able to then take all the VFX elements and integrate them using this 3D depth information, which was really cool. And I think, you know, but one of the things that can fall down if you've got lots of real elements you're trying to integrate is it can look like a collage, or it can feel like it's not really there. But because of this depth information, we could have like trees disappearing into the mist and rain going behind raindrops and going behind characters that were walking across screen and snow drifts like wrapping around plants. So we could do all of that without having to rotoscope and without having to do really complicated things. This is one of our very early tests. You see a rig still in love with it.
It's beautifully how all these kind of craftsmanships and different approaches, and where like 2D and 3D and stereoscopical and new technology still beautifully comes together in this handmade kind of experience, right? So it's not that technology takes over, like the technology is really like blending in the overall image.
Absolutely, yeah. No, the VFX team are absolutely incredible group of artists, you know, who've I think they're really, well, from what they would say anyway, was that they're really delighted to have these like raw elements to work with, because it was a kind of a gift to have real material to integrate. But the way they did it and the kind of the artistic eye that was put onto how these things were integrated was really amazing. So yeah, we were very, very lucky to have.
Mikey, thank you so much for sharing all your insights, this in-depth information from behind the scenes, also to tell us like about all your career and all your decisions. And thank you so much. And hopefully we will meet soon for real, have a beer and make the dance floor a very unsafe area. So really looking forward to that.
Thank you, Leon.
I wish you the biggest audience in the world for the upcoming Robin. Oh, yeah, it's already there on screen, but everybody should definitely check it out and should watch it a few times during the Christmas holiday, for sure.
Right.
It's the best way to get some rest and get your children. All right. Mikey, thank you so much, and see you soon. Also, all the audience in their home, I hope you enjoyed this episode. Thank you so much for joining us, and see you at the new episode. And don't forget to subscribe and join us at an event. Okay, thank you so much. See ya. Bye-bye.